Ako si Teddy Baguilat, tubong Tuwali sa Ifugao at tubong Gandang sa Nueva Vizcaya. Isa pa akong katutubo. Tumatakbo po bilang senator sa 2022.
Hello everyone and welcome to the very first episode of Tech Talk, a virtual kwentuhan for the IT BPO employees. We are your hosts, Camille Pineda.
And Kiel Bejarano, and I hope you are as excited as we are in getting to know our future national leaders.
That's right, Kiel. But before we get to that, Kiel, it has been over a year since we last saw each other in person from seeing each other every day in the office. How are you?
Sinabi mo pa, I know we're missing each other a lot. But, you know, I'm very thrilled to be hosting the very first Tech Talk and to be doing this with you. Alam mo yan. You guys don't know this yet, but we are actually real-life best friends and we met in an IT BPO company.
That's right. And we started in this industry and we want to be successful as well here. And since you're very thrilled and excited, please do the honors of introducing our very first guest.
Nako, Camille, today, actually, we are going to have a TED Talk or a Teddy Talk, rather. We are pleased to be speaking with senatorial candidate Teddy Baguilat. Mr. Teddy Baguilat was the representative of the Lone District of Ifugao as well as its former governor. He is a champion for the rights of indigenous peoples and advocates for the environment, ethical and transparent governance, and agrarian reform. Also, guys, you can follow the conversation on Twitter with the hashtag TechTalkWithTeddy. It is an honor to meet you today, sir. Thank you for being our very first guest here in Tech Talk.
Hello, hello sir.
Sir. Thanks again for being with us.
Surprise! Our very So before anything else, sir, we want to know first, no? Kamusta po kayo? Did you learn any new hobbies during the pandemic? Did you read new books? Like si Kiel, bumalik sa pagbabike niya sa Cavite. We're curious, ano po ang pinagkakaabalahan nyo for the past 20 months in this pandemic?
Ang dami, actually, no? Of course, yung mga sa bahay, it's naging plantito. natutong magluto. No, so na-revive ko yung aking cooking skill for myself actually and our security guards, no, kasi during the time syempre yung mga frontline workers natin, yung mga security guards, utility personnel, so I cook for them. And yeah, na kahit papaano, no, nabawasan yung aking timbang because I took biking. I bike and also I started actually before the pandemic mountain climbing, mountain hiking. Ang dami pala mga bundok dito sa malapit lang sa Metro Manila, sa Rizal, sa Montalban, nakadalawang trilogy na kami. So every time there's a window in the lockdown, yan na lang for mental health and also for exercise. Meron kaming grupo na umaakit ng mga kabundok. Basically, that's my life. First, Netflix. I became a K-drama fan. Yeah. Nakatapos rin ng mga, I think, around 3 to 4, no, TV series. And that's why we started yung aming social enterprise, yung Toy Cordillera Landing on You. It is, of course, an offshoot of the crash landing on You. Wherein we help producers from the Cordillera, no, yung mga indigenous communities na nahihirapan magdala ng produkto nila sa kamay nila. And also did service to our consumers here in the city by bringing them produce from the Cordillera, from indigenous communities, na diretso from the producer to the consumers here. So I think yun na rin yung lumakas, no, industriya dito sa during the pandemic, no, yung small traders, no, of goods, no, helping mga local communities bring directly to the consumers their products, no. So medyo marami-rami naman ang ating nagawa, marami-rami naman yung naganap during the pandemic. That's how you live and adjust, no, during pandemic life.
Yes, I agree, sir, Daddy. Actually, sa mga narinig ko, very productive po yung inyong naging mga pinagkabalahan, especially dun sa pag-ayos ng ploy, and that's very interesting. And yung pagbabike, especially sa akin po, actually, ako din, nag-start ako magbike ulit, like what Camille said. I went back to my hometown and then nag-iikot ako dito, nagbabike, revisiting old places, and it's very good for your mental health po. Kasi actually sobrang personal sa akin ng mga nangyayari ngayon. Personally, I was really affected. Nagkaroon po yung family ko ng COVID. I even lost someone because of this. But I'm very happy na we're slowly recovering, especially with the vaccines. Unti-unti na tayong umahon. And, you know, I'm fully vaccinated myself. A lot of my friends are getting vaccinated. Camille's vaccinated, like my family members, and I'm very happy with this. So, with this, speaking of vaccines, sir, I'm going to start na po with the big questions, with the heavy questions. No. Can you imagine yourself being part of IATF? Or what if you were a part of it, of IATF? And if you were the Secretary of Health, what's one thing you would have done differently?
Oh, a lot. Yung mindset. Yung mindset na lang nung the leaders or the Secretary of the Department of Health, yung malasakit niya doon sa mga frontline health workers. Because kung tutuusin talaga, no, Kam and Kiel, may protocols naman ng Department of Health. Again, in government for almost 30 years, meron naman talaga silang mga health protocols on how to respond to the pandemic. There's also a budget, although kulang, kasi hindi na paghandaan talaga ng husto, no, mabagal yung response. But now we have a budget. Ang implementers mo are your health workers, yung mga doktor, yung mga nurses, yung mga midwives, no, yung mga medical technologies, those who are working in our hospitals, in our clinics, in our health stations. Tapos nakakaasar kung maririnig mo na kinakailangan pa mag-rally yung mga health workers para matanggap nila yung kanilang hazard pay that they're supposed to be receiving because of the risks that they are taking in responding to this pandemic. That in itself already says a lot about the attitude of the IATF or the Secretary of Health, Department of Health. Kung mismo yung frontline health workers hindi mo naaalagaan, paano ka makakapag-respond, no, effectively during the pandemic? So sa akin lang, if you're going to ask me what one thing that they should have done, yung malasakit lang talaga, yung pagtulong nila, mabilis na pagtulong nila sa mga health workers. Imagine nung nagsimula tong pandemic, ang dami mga nagre-reklamo ng mga health workers na kulang yung PPEs nila. Kinakailangan pang tumulong ang private sector, the Office of the Vice President, si Lenny, na tumugon sa pangangailangan ng mga basic needs of health workers in responding to this pandemic. Kasi PPE is basic para maprotektahan mo yung sarili mo. If our health workers get sick, how can they respond to the patients? At yun nga, nung unang kasagsagan nitong pandemic, di ba ang daming mga doktor, mga nurses, nagka-COVID, ang daming mga namatay. That shows a lot about the lack of equipment of the Department of Health at saka yung mga health workers natin in dealing with this pandemic. So yun lang, yung pagmamalasakit at yung pagtulong doon sa health workers sa akin, yung pinaka-basic na mahalaga.
I actually agree with that, Sir Teddy. Malasakit really goes a long way. And that's very interesting to hear. But I also want to go back to your experience, yung rehiyon nyo. Since a lot of the news, di ba po, medyo focus sa Metro Manila, they're very Metro-centric. I'm curious naman po, kamusta po doon sa region nyo? Kamusta po yung mga tao doon, mga estudyante, mga negosyo nung pandemic at ngayon po?
Of course, affected rin, no, yung mga provinces. Hmm. Initially, not as much as Metro Manila, but of course, when people started going home, kasi maraming mga kababayan namin nagkatrabaho sa mga syudad, and then nung nawalan sila ng kabuhayan, most of them opted to go home to the provinces. And that's where you had infections in the provinces, including the Cordilleras, including Ipugao. So, yun din yung balakid, no? Yun din yung hamon. Kasi marami sa mga provincial health facilities natin ay hindi handa to cope with pandemic. Kasi nga, lahat binuhos dito sa Metro Manila. Understandably, because yung mataas yung infections, no? At saka mortality rates. Pero once na nagsumiklab rin doon sa mga probinsya, hindi rin handa yung mga provincial at saka municipal governments, no? So, kinakailangan talagang ako mismo, I started a donation drive rin for our province, no? Supplying them PPEs, no? Alcohol, mga basic, no? Masks, and gloves. Nawala rin yung mga health workers namin ng mga sapat na kagamitan, no? And so now at least medyo nako-control na rin, no? Because a lot of the provinces impose strict health protocols na rin, no? But ang pagkakaiba talaga is pag pumunta ka sa probinsya, minsan hindi mo nadarama na may pandemic. Marami pa rin mga kababayan ang walang masks. Mapapansin mo yan, pag dito sa Metro Manila, everybody. Part of the fashion wear is the mask.
Sa ito, sir, lumipat din po ako ng probinsya. Nanay ko, lumipat din po ng probinsya. Lahat kami umalis ng Metro Manila.
But yun yan, most of them actually parang, parang back to normal lang. Lumalabas sila, walang mask. Meron pa rin mga, lalo na yung nasa amin, marami kasing mga rituals doon, no? Pag namatay, may mga ritual, may mga engagement, no? Doon nagkakaroon ng spreader events kasi nagkaroon ng ritual, everybody is invited, yung buong tribo eh, nagpa-participate sa, let's say, engagement ritual. So hindi lang yung pamilya yung nagkukumpulan, pati yung buong tribo. So that's why nagkaroon ng mga spreader events rin also in the provinces, especially in indigenous communities. No? Nakadalasan naman, usually, hindi sila natatamaan ng pandemic na nanggaling sa mga syudad, no? So right now, nagkakaroon rin ng problema in the provinces, but not as bad as Metro Manila, but not as bad as the urban centers.
I definitely agree, sir. Actually, sobrang interesado po ako sa mga nababanggit niyo about, especially sa ating indigenous communities. Kasi I'm really a fan. Even yung textiles, I always purchase. But I'm really interested po during your terms as governor and congressman, natanggal sa list ng poorest provinces ang Ifugao. I'm asking this because, you know, as an artist po and or a designer or someone working in the ITBPO industry, we're always looking forward, looking for the best practices, I mean. So, kayo po as a seasoned public servant, ano po sa palagay niyo ang nagawa niyo sa Ifugao na pwede mag-work sa buong Pilipinas?
Yung sa akin, yung mindset na walang iwanan. Ang uri kasi ng development natin sa Pilipinas, kahit umangat yung ekonomiya natin, let's say, taas yung ating rate of development, pero marami pa rin sa mga kababayan natin ang hindi na iaangat mong kanilang kabuhayan. So there's a kulang sa inclusivity. Kaya nga pag pinag-uusapan natin ang sustainable development, importante yung inclusivity. Sabi nga nila, itong panahon ni Pinoy, no, ang ganda ng ekonomiya, dumami ang middle class o lumaganap yung mga small and medium enterprises. Pero marami pa rin ang mga mahihirap, no? Yung mga magkasaka, yung mga katutubo, those in the rural provinces. Most of our infrastructure programs are concentrated in the urban centers. Kaya marami tuloy mga taga-probinsya ang pumupunta sa syudad because ang sa tingin nilang development is in the urban centers. So kami sa Ifugao, ganun ang ginawa namin because, again, most of the developments were in the poblacion area, yung sentro, yung capital town. So we had to identify kung gusto mo talagang maiahon yung buong probinsya na walang iwanan. In-identify namin yung mga poorest barangays. Mm-hmm. And from there, doon namin binuhos yung programa ng government. So nothing really special about it. It's just a matter of prioritizing the government resources doon sa poorest of the poor. So pagkatapos nang naiaho na namin yung, let's say, 10 poorest barangays, no, in the province, then we again identify the next set of poorest barangays. Buhos ang livelihood doon, buhos ang health support to health facilities, education, and other social services of the government. Hanggang at least, kahit pa paano, no, nagkaroon ng development na nakasama yung mga nasa laylayan, yung mga mas mahihirap, no? So that to me was our formula, and I hope, no, ganun din ang pagtingin natin, no, especially kung we want to recover from this pandemic, kasi anybody who becomes our next president, hopefully si VP Lenny, no, kasi ang ganda ng kanyang programa, but ang talagang magiging malaking hamon is how do we build back better. yung ating economic recovery program after na matalo natin ang pandemic. Merong programa si VP Lenny dito, pero what next? And sa akin, the kind of economic development that we should look at is one, it's more environment friendly, and second, it's more inclusive. Para talaga yung mga nasa laylayan, yung mga dati nang tinutulungan ni VP Lenny, ay maiangat naman yung kanilang kabuhayan at masama doon sa development ng ating bansa.
All right. So, Sir Teddy, maraming salamat po sa pag-share ng mga bagay na yan sa amin. And I believe talagang kailangan lang po natin magtulungan para umahon. I believe yung micro efforts talaga natin, malaki yung epekto niyan, no? Lalo na sa panahon ngayon. So, salamat po sa pag-share ng mga bagay.
That's right. And we're actually very excited to see this kind of, you know, energy in the Senate. And thank you for sharing those. But sir, can I also ask you something that is relevant to IT BPO sector today? As you know, yung IT BPO workers po natin, we're the first to pivot to digital first and remote only working in the early days of the pandemic. Sa totoo lang po, we are somehow the new economic frontliners. And this pandemic, we've seen how gaano po ka-importante yung mga kumpanya to have options for hybrid working arrangements. So my question, sir, is how do you think we can improve labor and employment conditions post-pandemic, especially for the IT BPO industry?
Yeah, actually, kayo yung mga bagong bayani natin. Kasi, not just during the pandemic, pero pag may bagyo, di ba? Pag grabe ang baha sa Metro Manila, call center agents are still required to report to work. Karamihan sa kanila, doon na talaga natutulog. No? So sa akin, I'm fully supportive on how to institutionalize yung hybrid working arrangements. Ako kasi nung governor ako sa Ifugao, yung aking first engagement with the BPO industry was trying to establish a BPO industry in Ifugao. Ang problema namin kasi nagkaroon kami ng training, we partnered with a call center company, no, BPO company, training doon sa mga young Ifugaos kasi there's particular liking to Cordilleras because of our certain diction, regional diction of Cordilleras. That's why they're very popular, no, in terms of employment to call centers. Most of them are in Baguio City. So gusto nila sa Ifugao. Ang problem, of course, in Ifugao is connectivity. It's always really been a problem pagdating sa countryside. But ang idea ko at that time is because we don't have big buildings, mabundukin doon eh. So it's really very difficult to establish an industrial complex. So really work at home. After the train na yung mga kabataan namin, how could we look at arrangements where they work in their barangays? Ang problem talaga was connectivity. But I guess here in the cities, no, walang problema yon. No? I think that's also important for call center agents who experience mental health problems. Alam naman natin na mental health is also a challenge for a lot of call center agents. And these hybrid arrangements help address, no, mental health problems in the industry. Lalong-lalo na ako ay isa sa mga principal author ng National Mental Health Law. So, mabibigyan ng lunas itong problema ng Pilipinas sa mental health because in fact sa mga surveys, no, doon lang sa government sector sabi nila 30% of the government working force experience mental health problems. Paano pa kaya sa call center industry, no? One thing also na I'd like to push for is yung Magna Carta for call center agents, no. I was able to read and talk to some friends, no, who are in the industry, and it's one thing that they'd like to really also pursue, like to study that and see if it can be pursued in the Senate. While we have existing laws, no, yung on occupational and health safety, no, occupational safety and health law, no, pero maganda rin sigurong pag-usapan kung paano natin isusulong yung karapatan ng mga call center agents, no, better office arrangements, no, yung sa kanilang health trend in terms of health insurance, no, the right to unionize. I think that's something that also some call center agents would like to pursue, no, and yun nga yung pursuing yung working arrangements at home. Because I think kung magiging kalakaran na yan sa BPO industry, no, sa IT industry, then even persons with disabilities can be employed, no, in the sector. Ako rin kasi isang nagtutulak ng anti-discrimination bill for senior citizens, persons with disabilities, LGBT, mga katutubo. And one of the things that persons with disabilities always reveal during our consultations with them is yung kanilang yung problema sa pagkuha ng trabaho. And I'd like to think that if you have more work at home arrangements, then pwede sila doon sa bahay na lang magtrabaho doon sa BPO industry instead of, you know, going to the offices. And marami sa mga offices natin are not actually equipped with accessibility arrangements, no, for persons with disabilities. So ako very much supportive in trying to institutionalize these hybrid working arrangements, no, for the reasons that I mentioned.
Well, I'm very happy to hear this, Sir Teddy. And sana nga po we're able to update yung mga outdated and obsolete employment standards natin, no, as we are also talking about the future of work. So sa totoo lang, ang hirap po talaga pag-usapan ng future of work if 5 Mbps lang po yung ating internet.
Yeah.
Actually, totoo po yan. And ako din po mismo sa work, usually nadi-disconnect ako, nahihirapan ako mag-connect even when I'm talking to clients and even when I'm doing like interviews, like for example now meron akong takot na baka ma-disconnect ako. And you know, I'm sure I'm not alone in this. So during the pandemic, the digital divide was felt by more Filipinos, students became distance learners, and employees became remote workers overnight, as we said. Even businesses had to pivot din po to e-commerce. So I know po, you know, in-author nyo yung Free Wi-Fi Access Act, which I believe is a good start. Pero sir, ang bagat pa rin ng internet natin. You have been a 3-term congressman, so I'm curious if you become part of the Senate, what laws would you propose in the Senate to address this? What other
things? Sa akin, ano eh, just improving the enforcement or the implementation of the laws that have been recently passed. Mm-hmm. Because yan, no, meron na yung Free Public Wi-Fi Access Act. Kami ni Senator Kiko Pangilinan, no, mga principal authors ito. Ako sa House, siya naman sa Senado. Mm-hmm. We have this Department of Information and Communication Technology, Data Privacy Act. Ang dami ng mga batas, no, when it comes to supporting the industry. But it's really the enforcement. Meron tayong Free Public Wi-Fi Access, which means that dapat sa mga schools, sa mga terminals, transportation terminals, sa mga barangay halls, no, sa mga munisipyo, public spaces where people converge, dapat may free public Wi-Fi. Pero ang problema nga, ganito, kulang sa pondo. So I think it's a matter really of providing more resources. And then, I don't know, I'm exploring the possibility of also pushing open source, no, kasi right now, ang ating connectivity is really provided by telecom industries, telecommunications. So kahit gusto mong magkaroon ng free public Wi-Fi sa mga probinsya, no, bigyan mo sana ng Wi-Fi access yung mga paaralan, it's still dependent on whether malakas ba yung Smart o yung Globe. No? So there are those who are pushing, especially for remote areas, no, yung tinatawag natin GDAS, geographically isolated and difficult to access areas, no, sa mga lugar ng mga katutubo. Maybe there can also be other providers that can be allowed by law, whether it's the local government or civil society organizations, na magtayo rin sa kanila ng internet services doon. No? Because right now, the law provides franchises to telecom to provide the internet services. So lahat tayo, we're dependent also on the telecom companies. No? So sa akin lang, in order to really bridge the digital divide, no, kinakailangan talagang pagtuunan ng pansin ng pamahalaan yung mga areas that are not usually serviced by the private sector. Private sector naman, it has to improve because it's a business, it's a competition also, no? Dumadami ng players na rin. So that's going to be to address the problems here in the urban centers. Pero ang gusto nga natin is bridging the digital divide. And talagang problema talaga sa mga probinsya. So how can you even also push for hybrid working arrangements, no, or make the BPO and IT industry more inclusive to also people working in the rural areas. If you don't increase also or make better the connectivity in these rural areas. So sa akin, maganda kung maraming mga players, big players and also yung mga independent and smaller players na bigyan ng pamahalaan ng support, no, para makapag-provide ng accessibility dito sa mga areas.
Actually, Sir Teddy, yan nga po yung sunod kong tanong sa inyo. Kasi since napag-usapan nga natin future of work, so yung mga estudyante, so yung future of work po, syempre yung industry na to depends on our talent pipeline, and yung future talents na to are the ones who are actually suffering right now kasi dahil sa distance and virtual learning. So yun nga po, na-mention nyo kanina, kung yung mga students na po dito sa Metro Manila, nahihirapan na po sila. Paano na po kaya yung mga nasa probinsya na walang laptop, walang internet connection? We just want to maybe for you to expound on this a little bit more. Like, what interventions do you think are needed to support students in the provinces? And how do you think we can make our future graduates globally competitive and future ready?
Importante rin yung support to CHED, no? To our state universities and colleges. Kasi talaga sa probinsya, wala masyadong mga private institutions. Most of our very good IT schools are here in the urban centers. But in the provinces, they really rely on state universities and colleges. Kaya nga yung aking first engagement din with IT students were students of our state university. Kasi marami akong mga personal scholars. And ang, at the time, no, when I was governor, ang talagang popular courses was, aside from education and criminology, was IT. Everybody was into IT. Problema, wala naman silang laptop. Wala silang mga gadgets. Even the state university itself, nag-solicit ang mga computers. No? So I think if we really want to be globally competitive, there has to be really lots of investments on education. We need to really triple the education budget, no, for both basic and higher education. Kasi yan ang formula why progressive countries like Japan or Singapore, no, or in Europe, no, they have this competitive edge. Kasi ang laki ng investment nila in education. No. At least now we have free tertiary education. Also a law which we supported. No. Pero kulang. Kulang talaga. No? Unlike in other countries na libre na yung kanilang tertiary education, ang ganda pa ng quality ng education nila. So I think it's really a matter of just investing. And in Congress kasi, in the Senate, the Congress and the Senate, they approve the budget. So sa akin, the mindset has to be putting more priority into education. That's how you make us globally competitive. I mean, the English faculty natin speaking English is already there. But actually, napag-iiwanan na rin tayo eh when it comes to science and technology. Lagi nating pinagmamayabang, ang galing natin kasi magaling tayo mag-English. Because that's our medium for instruction, di ba? Pero in terms of science, in terms of technology, in terms of mathematics, actually, nagkakaroon ng mga pagsusuri. Medyo na pag-iiwanan ng mga Pilipino. So we also need to invest, no, in terms of not just a budget for the education, but also trying to improve the quality of education that is being taught in basic and higher education, especially for the IT and BPO industry. Right now, kasi ang tingin nila, it's a specialized skill, no? So ang daming mga state universities na nagbukas ng kanilang courses, eventually nagsara rin. Kasi hindi maganda yung kalidad, no, ng tinuturo ng mga IT schools sa mga o IT departments sa state universities and colleges. So right now, everybody is also gravitating now to the cities because sa tingin nila, andito yung mga best IT schools. So again, if you're thinking of inclusivity, then we need to also improve the IT education in the provinces, in our state universities and colleges.
We very much agree with that, Sir Teddy.
Investment and quality education, that is very true. So, with all these hard questions, Sir Teddy, no, medyo nagiging seryoso na tayo. So, curious lang nito, you said earlier, naging nanonood kinong Netflix and naging K-drama fan na rin po kayo katulad ni Camille. Actually, si Camille Kiel. So, you even used Chloe as a... Chloe, I watched Chloe, actually. It's very good. Chloe as a captain for a social enterprise. Am I right, sir? Cordillera landing on you. So, if you're gonna rate it 1 to 10, 10 being the highest, gaano po kayo ka-diehard fan? Korean novela. Real talk na to, sir. Teddy.
Na-mention niyo yan kanina, sir, na nag-Netflix binge kayo, na-mention niyo yan. So, we just want to know,
just for fun, 1 to 10.
Panindigan ko na. Sige, let's put it at 8?
Okay. Mataas na, sir.
Ayaw ko lang talaga sa K-drama is ang haba ng mga episodes.
Madi-disconnect ka na, sir.
Napupuyat ka talaga, lalang-lalan na kung Chloe, di ba? Gusto mong panuorin agad yung second, di ba? Ano nangyari? Henry, di ba? Tapos, ang haba talaga. And then, but in terms of quality, no, wala ka naman talagang masabi sa Korean movie and TV productions. Na kahit pareho yung formula. Because ang Chloe naman, pareho rin sa Descendants of the Sun yung formula nila, di ba? Action, may romance, ganyan, comedy, ganyan. Pero the quality, I think that's the yung movie industry talaga ng Korea, not just movie industry but K-pop, di ba? Grabe talaga ang investment ng Korean government, no? Masasabi ko 'yan because I've been talking to some Koreans during international conferences. Nag-i-invest pala ang government. For them kasi that's part of their program for culture, eh, yung investing in the talents, no, of the entire entertainment industry, no, from filmmaking to script writing to production. So their talents, no? They're singers and their actors. So ang grabe talaga, it has become an academy in itself, no? But that's with government support. Later on na pumasok na rin syempre, of course, ang private sector. Maybe that's something you can learn.
Mukhang 10 kayo, hindi 8, ha? Honestly.
Parang medyo
pa tayo. Actually, hindi ko alam ni Kiel na very interesting yung sinabi niya na in government invests in that. So that's something new. So thank you for sharing that with us. So once again, Sir Teddy, maraming salamat for speaking with us today. We personally feel like we know you so much more and we are looking forward to learning more about you, your platform, and what you can do for the country. And before we officially end, sir, do you have any message for everyone who's tuned in right now?
Yeah, thank you for listening to me. I'm sure marami pa sa inyo hindi pa nakikilala. So that's why I'm happy for this invitation to share my thoughts, not just on the usual things that I advocate for, which is kalikasan, kultura, at karapatan, but also my ideas about the industry itself. No, inaamin ko, no, my engagement with the BPO and IT industry is very much limited. No? But I've been talking to the sector, particularly nga dun sa Magna Carta for call center agents, and also yung experience ko as a governor in terms of also promoting the industry in my province. So I'm very happy. Actually, this is also a learning session for me. Kasi sa akin, bilang isang mababatas, ang principle ko is, hindi naman namin alam lahat. Eh. Kung magtutulak tayo ng batas, we have to learn from the sector itself. Marami kasi nangyayari. So ito na yung batas, ito na yung tinutulak natin. At ang kakaroon ng mga hearings sa Kongreso at sa Senado, kami-kami lang yung nag-uusap. So maganda na right now, we are also getting inputs from the stakeholders from the industry itself. So thank you very much for this learning session also for me. Thank you.
Maraming salamat muli, Sir Teddy. It's an honor actually to hear you speak today. At maraming salamat din sa lahat ng nanonood sa atin. Sana marami kayong natutunan with Senatorial Candidate Teddy Baguilat. So alright, this has been your host, Kiel Bejarano.
And Camille Pinada, please stay tuned for more Tech Talk, a virtual kwentuhan for the IT BPO employees. You can follow the conversation with a hashtag on Twitter with a hashtag Tech Talk with Teddy. Again, thank you very much, everyone. Get vaccinated, stay safe.
And vote wisely. And shout out to our Kakamtinks.
Thank you, Sir Teddy. Bye-bye po.
Itetem kahunggo pa tede tunna katolak Anal po ni Dadawi, ni Dadawi, dawin boble, itetem, itetem, ino ayo tahunggo pag. Magandang araw sa inyong lahat. Ako si Teddy Baguilat, tubong Tuwali sa Ifugao at tubong Gandang sa Nueva Vizcaya. Isa pa akong katutubo. Tumatakbo po bilang senator sa 2022. Humihingi po kami ng inyong tulong sa ating mithiin na magkaroon po tayo ng kauna-unahang katutubong senador. Hindi naman po ako bago sa larangan ng public service. Dati po akong konsehal sa Kiangan, Ifugao, tapos naging mayor for 6 years. Naging governor for 6 years. Kaya malawak naman pong aking karanasan bilang isang lokal na opisyal, at yun po ang gusto ko rin pong maiambag sa Senado, ang ating expertise o perspektiva ng isang lokal na opisyal. Malawak rin pong aking karanasan bilang isang mamabatas. 9 years po tayo sa Kongreso. Naging chairman po ako ng Committee on Indigenous Peoples. Pinaglaban po natin ang karapatan ng mga katutubo. Naging chairman rin ng Committee on Agrarian Reform. Pinaglaban naman po natin ang kapakanan ng mga magsasaka. Sa mga batas naman po na ating itinulak sa Kongreso, mayroon po tayo sa mga kabataan tulad ng Free Tertiary Education Act, ang Free Public Wi-Fi Access Act, para naman po sa mga magsasaka, ang Sagipsaka Law, at para naman po sa mga kababaihan, tayo po ang kaisa-isang lalaking principal author ng Expanded Maternity Leave Act. Sa international advocacy, ako po ay presidente ng Global Indigenous Community Conserve Areas Consortium, isa pong international organization ng mga katutubong pamayanan at lokal na komunidad na nagtutulak sa pagkilala ng pamumuno ng mga lokal na communities and indigenous peoples sa biodiversity doon sa kanilang lugar. Ako rin po ay nagsilbing executive director ng ASEAN Parliamentarians for Human Rights. Ang aking pong ipaglalaban sa Senado ay 3K. Andiyan po ang kultura. Kultura po ng mga katutubo. Kultura po ng Pilipino. Andiyan rin po, importante, ang kalikasan. Ang kalikasan ay hindi lang para sa ating bansa, kundi para sa ating planeta. At pangatlo ay ang karapatan. Karapatan po ng mga katutubo, ng mga magsasaka, ng bata, ng mga kababaihan, ng mga kabataan, karapatan po ng mga mamamayang Pilipino. Maraming salamat sa dakilang volunteers ng Team Robredo Pangilinan o Tropa. Mag-recruit pa tayo, magparami tayo. And positive campaign, huwag tayo makipag-away. Sabi nga ni Ma'am Lenny, radical love. Kita-kita ulit!